Okay, so let's look at what a digital signature actually looks like. So with a digital signature, we want Bob to prove that he has digitally signed a message to Alice, and for Alice to prove that that message has been signed only by him and also that it hasn't been changed. So one of the most common formats that we get for our signatures is to generate the values of R and S. So we'll try to outline how these values are generated and then the format of them and give a few examples of how we can create some code to be able to read them. Okay, so what we have with our digital signatures is that we have Bob and we have Alice here. Okay, so Bob will have his private key here and will also have his public key. So here is his public key here. Okay, Alice can also have her own keys, but in this case, all we really want to do is to prove that Bob has signed a message with his private key. So if we take the message here we are, and what we normally do is take a hash of the message, and then we apply our private key on to produce a signature. So in this case, we will create our signature here, and the signature we create is an R and an S value. So we have the private key, we have the message, and then often we have a random value of K, called a nonce value, which goes in to produce R, comma S. So then Bob sends the message over to Alice, also sends the R and the S value, and then she will use Bob's public key to do a check on the message or the signature. She'll take a hash of the message. She'll then take Bob's public key and then check the R and S values. She doesn't need the K value or the nonce value that was used to randomize the R and S values. All she needs is the R and the S value, the public key from Bob and the message. And if things check out, then everything is fine there. Okay, so later on we'll have a look at how we can actually support the R and the S value as a signature so that Alice can read it. The two main methods that are used for this are elliptic curve ECDSA digital signature algorithm, elliptic curve digital signature algorithm, or we can use DSS. This one uses RSA to be able to sign the message, where we sign with an RSA private key and we will prove with the public key. More common these days is to use elliptic curve methods rather than to use RSA. RSA leads to very big long keys, typically 2K and even up to 4K, where here we often just have 256-bit keys. The way the elliptic curve works is that we have our elliptic curve method, and one of the most basic is in this form here, mod p. Okay, so we specify our elliptic curve with an a value, a b value, and a p value. We also define n, the order, and n is the total number of points on the curve. So in the continuous form, it looks like this graph here, but obviously, if we're using discrete points, such as with the mod p, we end up with scattered points. But basically, what we have is that on our curve, we have a g value, and G is the base point. It is the point that we can start our operations. And then we work out our private key, which is a random value. If we use a 256-bit curve, such as sept256k1, then we have a 256-bit value. We then multiply our base point with the scalar value, which is pk, 256 bits. This operation is basically we add g lots of times. We add a pk times, so it's g plus g plus g, so on, until we get the point pk. And it's quite an efficient operation, an elliptic curve. So our public key, sorry, this is our secret key, that should be sk there. Our secret key is our private key, and our public key, pk, is sk times g. And this is a point. So if this is 256 bits in a 256-bit curve, this is 512 bits because it's an xy point on the curve. There are some curves that we ignore the y value, such as curve 25519 and curve 448, and we only deal with the x value. But in most other curves, our standard curves, we use the x and the y point. So our public key becomes an xy point. When we create our signature, we create integer values as the same size as our base curve. So typical curves that we have here is the one that's used in Bitcoin, sept256k1. We might also have one of the NIST defined curves, 256 or P192. The 192 identifies the number of bits that we're going to be using, and that will define the size of the R and the S value that we have. The public key, as I said, will be double that size because it has an X and Y coordinate. Okay, so that's the two main methods. We'll look mainly at elliptic curve, DSA in this presentation. Okay, so here's the basic method that we're going to use. Bob generates a random value. Let's say it's 256, but random value. That is his private key. He then generates the public key from this by taking the base point and multiplying it by his privileged key, his private key, to give his public key. So that's pk and that's sk there. He takes the message, he hashes the message here, then takes a random value k and produces a point r, which is k times g. We only typically need the x coordinate of the r value. So although that's a coordinate point for the r value that we'll create, we will just take the x coordinate from it. And then Bob calculates k to the minus 1. And it must be, that's mod n. N is the order. The inverse of k mod n, which is our standard operation. And then that's multiplied by the hash of the message plus r times the secret key gives us the value of s. We then create that as a signature value as two integers r and s. So how does Alice then check that? Okay, so Bob will send over his private key, will send the message over, and then from these, from the r and the s value, we want Alice to be able to validate that. So initially Alice takes a hash of the message, then takes the S value and works out the inverse mod of N, the inverse of S mod N to give the C value. We then take the hash value that we calculated here, multiply by the C value, mod N, And then for the second value, we will take the R value and the C value, mod m. We then work at a new point on the elliptic curve, which is u1 times g and u2 times the public key of Bob. And then if that point is equal to the x value, then the signature is correct. So in this way, we can actually validate that Bob signed it using the public key, using the message, and using the R and the S value. So we can use lots of different curves if we want. The NIST P256, 256-bit curve, 192, 512, if we want even more security, and 256K1 is used with Bitcoin. So here's an example of some signatures that we have. Here's the private key. Remember, that's a scalar value. In this case, we're using 256 bits. So that's a 256-bit key here. And so the public key is an XY point. It's the base point. The base point is here, multiplied by the private key to give us the public key. Okay, so this is Bob's private key and Bob's public key. It will then take the message, and in this case the message is just hello. It will then use the method that we showed to be able to generate an R and an S value here. Here's the values here as numbers, but we can see we also define it in terms of signature. You can identify this because it's starting with a 30, as we'll see later. Okay, so these are some examples. So we'll just run a few more and we can select different types of curves. So we'll select this one here, and we can see here, there's the base point on this curve. There is the private key. There's the public key. And we eventually validate that this is true. There's the signature and the R and the S value. And we'll do a quick check there. So the code, if you're interested, is here. And this allows us to be able to generate this signature. But you can see there are many different ways that we could actually perform this, including the brain pool methods and this one here. Okay, so the way that we translate, so we have a problem in that we want to make sure that every machine can read this no matter what type of computer it is. So we encapsulate the two integer values into what's called the DIR format. And this is an encoding format which you can encapsulate virtually any type of value within it. In its base form, it's a binary format. And we have hexadecimal sequences for the byte values. So a hexadecimal 30 identifies a sequence or something is coming later. 03 identifies a bit array, and 02 identifies an integer. In this case, the R and the S value will be represented in as 02 or as integers. So here's a signature that we saw earlier in there. So what we want to be able to do is to interpret that hexadecimal stream and to be able to work out the values of R and S in there. So the first thing we come across is the 30, and then the next number is the number of bytes that will follow. Okay, so there should be 35 bytes after this to be able to identify the values coming next. The next value after the length is the tag identifier for the type. So in this case, it's 02, which is an integer. And then we identify there are 19 bytes that follow there. Remember, it's 19 hexadecimal. So 19 hexadecimal comes out as 25 in decimal, which means there are 25 bytes after that. Then we get, after the 25 bytes, we get 02 and an 18. 18 hexadecimal is 24. So the value here is the S value, and the value here is the R value and the S value. We can see here they're 00, so we can ignore them. So both are of length 24 bytes. 24 bytes, if we multiply up by 8, gives us 192 bits. And that fits our curve, because this is curve 192, which is a 192-bit curve. If we take another example, and this time we've got a 256-bit curve using the Bitcoin curve, and here's the signature that we might have. Maybe someone's making a transaction for us, signing it with the private key, and then we'll be able to prove it with this RS signature and the public key. So we'll parse again. There are 46 bytes after this. We then hit a 02. There it's there. And then 21 hex defines the number of bytes that come after it. And that is 21 is actually 33 bytes, but we can see we've got one off there. So we end up with 32 bytes of the R value. Then we get a 02. The 02 is here. And then this is the S value that comes along here. 21 hex bytes, which is 32 bytes, gives us the S value here. So that's 32 bytes long, or 256 bits, to give us our R and our S value here. Okay, so here's an example here with a PEM format, and we can easily interpret that. We can see the first thing we come across is the 30, followed by the 02, and then our value here is an integer, then our value here is another integer. If we want, we can compartmentalize that into a base64 signature as we have here. So let's have a look at the code which does that. So we can take an example here. So we'll try this one here. There's a PEM, and there's the R value and the S value in there. So the code itself is an ASN1 reader, and it will go through until it finds the right tags for that one. So of course we're dealing with a 02, so it will interpret the 02 to be able to give us our values. And these are some of the definitions that we have for that format in there. But we'll have a look at this code here, and we'll just run an example here. So there's the code, and we'll see if we can define another curve just to test. And this is the, we'll go for this 160 value. So we can basically just copy and paste that, put it in there, and then run it through, and hopefully that will work for us. Okay, so there's the R value, and there's the S value in this digital signature. Okay, so that's been an outline of using the R and the S value and how we can create our signature in a DER format. Okay, thank you.